So I'm not talking about manuscriptology in a direct way, but I'll show you in this context how it will be available. So Parashara Tantram is the text that I'm talking about. It's a reconstructed text. So what do I mean by reconstructed? I'll just explain, and also obviously I'll explain what this text is about. Okay. So let me first introduce myself. I work as a research associate in the Center for Ancient History and Culture, Jain University. It's in JP Nagar. And it was started by Professor R. N. Iyengar, who is actually supposed to come here for presenting it, but he is out on some other work. So this center was established in 2011, and it is involved in publishing unpublished works. Not just transcription, but with proper discussion, comparative analysis, and so on. So till now, Parashara Tantram has been published. Then Narada Shilpam was released last year. It is a text on civil engineering, and there have been many papers published. And current research on Vriddhagargiya Jyotisham, about which my colleague presented today morning, and some research on Samaveda and music, and this kind of research is going on. Okay, so let me come to Parashara Tantram. Parashara Tantram is actually an ancient work on astronomy and other natural sciences. So it is not restricted to astronomy, but it also has information on rainfall, earthquakes, and things like that. So that is the basic idea about Parashara Tantram. Now, coming back to its astronomical aspect. Astronomy in India can be broadly divided into two periods. One is known as pre-Siddhantic and other is known as Siddhantic. So Siddhantic works, people generally know some names. For example, Aryabhatta, Bhaskara 1, 2, Nilakantha Somayaji, so many names are there. But this pre-Siddhantic, which means works before Shaka era. So we are right now in Shaka 1941. So imagine there was a zero Shaka or one Shaka. Before that Shaka is roughly known as pre-Siddhantic because there is a very distinct nature to these texts by which we divide it into these two distinct periods. Now I have displayed some important texts or source texts for these two periods. I'll just give you some examples. So the entire Vedic corpus, including four Vedas, Itihasa Dvayam, so Ramayanam Mahabharatam, then Parashara Tantram also comes in this category. Then the Vriddhagargiya Jyotisham, which my friend talked about. Then there are other texts. One very famous text is Vedanga Jyotisham by Lagadha. All this comes under ancient astronomical literature. And the Siddhantic period, which is a later period, which is we can say around the last 1800 years, it has so many texts, including Panchasiddhantika by Varahamihira, Brihat Samhita by the same person, then Aryabhatiyam, Brahmasputta Siddhantam, and so many texts. I have just listed some of them. Anyway, so Parashara Tantram comes under the text or the category pre-Siddhantic because it has a lot of observational astronomy and very less to almost no calculation. So mathematical part is less, but we have a huge amount of observational information. So some of the topics that Parashara, so assuming that Parashara is a person and his Shishya Parampara also included. So it was not. So the very ancient texts, what we find is they were most likely community texts. So it was an accretive tradition. So his Shishyas will also add to it, things like that. So he includes many topics like Grahachara, all kinds of grahas, including Tara grahas and Chandra, Surya, all of the Chandrachara is less, but anyway. So movement of all the planets, that information is included. And then apart from the astronomical aspects, we also have Bhukampaha, Pravarshanam, which is rainfall. He talks about nucleation of clouds and so many other things like this. And anomalies. So this slide is just to show the nature of content in this work, and so eventually why it is important. Okay, so now I want to talk about this text, its reconstruction, and in context of manuscriptology. So the work has been published about 6 years ago from Jain University Press. So you can, if you are interested, you can actually buy the copy and read the discussion with respect to each and every topic. But what I wanted to emphasize is, Parashara Tantram, unlike the usual works we have, for example, we collect 8 manuscripts, 10 manuscripts, and then analyze, compare readings, and then publish them. Similar to how my colleague would have explained about Vriddhagargiya Jyotisham today. But then, Parashara Tantram couldn't be done like that because we couldn't locate, at least till now, any original manuscript that said, okay, Parashareno Uktam, and it is a cogent text that has that particular person and parampara's work. So, what had to be done was, collect quotations of Parashara from various works and their commentaries, and then they have to be ordered in a sequence based on the general parampara of astronomy. So, even though works like Brihat Parashara, Hora Shastram, and so many other kinds of works like Parashara Siddhantaha, they are all available in the name of Parashara, once we start exploring them, they don't have that particular content which we are looking for, which is quoted in other texts like Brihat Samhita. So, in the context of manuscriptology, it would be like this. We need to definitely keep an eye out for any further manuscripts which might actually contain this text, because there are bundles sometimes, and as other people have also mentioned, so many manuscripts are in bundles, and then maybe in between there is a work, it may not have been actually called out in the index or in the labeling page. Okay. But then the question comes up, if this is the case, then why do we actually need to collect the references and publish a text? Publish it as a text. That is because it is used in a comparative analysis with other kind of manuscriptology work. For example, there are other works like Vriddhagargiya Jyotisham which need to be published. But then we also need to know whether a particular concept that is here was there earlier. And if there is a work earlier, which we say it is Parashara Tantram, earlier to Garga, then that work needs to come out so that we have a smooth connection between how the parampara evolved. And manuscripts in reconstruction also, in reconstructing this particular work, Parashara Tantram, other manuscripts, manuscripts of later works, they are also helpful in using. What I'm trying to say is how manuscriptology and concepts of manuscriptology help in reconstruction, how reconstruction helps in further manuscriptology. And one more thing we found out recently is that there are published works from which we can collect quotations and then reconstruct a text, say for example. Even then, the published texts may not be critical editions. So, in that case, we are not completely sure whether that is the ultimate reading for a particular shloka. So, we need manuscripts for those texts also. Okay, the first point I have already mentioned, reconstructed text is important because it helps in further manuscriptology of other texts. And one more reason why reconstructing is important, even though manuscripts are not available, is we know how a parampara has evolved. For example, comets. There are 26 comets mentioned in Parashara Tantram, not just by name, but with description. How the tail looked, how bright it was moving, when it rose and when it set, what kind of effects it caused. So many details are given. But, and the one interesting aspect is, I'll just quickly show a table later on. So there is a particular comet that comes up. And then after 115 years, there is another comet seen. After that, after 130 years, another comet is seen. There is a huge list like this, about 26 names. And the year numbers are given. So this is the observation recorded actually in Parashara Tantram as quoted in other texts. But Brihat Samhita, which is the more famous text by Varaha Mihira, in that text he actually neglects this information. If we look at the section on comets, he doesn't give the year numbers. He has neglected it. So we know that there has been a loss of information and what was considered more important and later less important. So to analyze a complete or to have a complete view of the history of science, also we need to have these texts. And one more important point would be solar zodiac. So I mean, this word zodiac is a little confusing because it's used in the sense of Rashi nowadays. But the concept of six ritus, each having 2 months, this is a problematic concept for some of them because they say this was borrowed from Babylon or Greece. So now we find that proper nakshatras are indicated for proper seasons so that we can actually locate when this text was probably written. So that is first time mentioned in Parashara Tantram. Unless we cull out the references and make a text out of it, we really don't know how the parampara has evolved. And so with the help of that, we can also arrive at a rough chronology of how the sciences has evolved. Anyway, so this is just a snapshot I'm giving. The references used for reconstructing it, the text was, one is called Adbhuta Sagara. This was by Ballala Sena. So for example, if you look at the text, Etebhyo ye udayante tanaha parasharaha. So he says, Parashara says, this is what it is. So he quotes it like that in his text. So we take that reference and appropriately include it in the section on comets. Similarly, Tathacha Bhagavan Parasharaha. This is a Utpala's commentary on Brihat Samhita. So this portion is also taken from here. So just giving an example of how a reconstruction is made. Okay, so this is a huge list. I really don't want to dwell on this, but just giving an example. So 26 comets are listed in Parashara Tantram. Vasa Ketu, Asti Ketu, Shastra Ketu, Kumuda Ketu, so many things. And for each one, he describes how the tail looks, how long it takes, how long it is seen in the sky, in what direction it came up and where it set, and so many other details. Just compiled it for some other purpose. Anyway, so he ends up with Dhuma Ketu, and later texts include one more called Gada Ketu. So what we need to know is there is a popular perception that our people did not worry about comets and other kind of phenomena. That's not true. We really need to study these things in more detail to get more information. Anyway, I wouldn't go into this. This is actually the Ritu Chakra I talked about. So this needs a lot of time to explain, so I'll just skip over it. So basically what this means is he states in which particular nakshatra when Surya is, Shishira Ritu starts, and when Shishira Ritu ends, when does the next Ritu start. With the help of this information, we can conclude roughly or estimate roughly when he lived. This would be around minus 1400 Shaka, or if you want to tell in terms of Christian era, it would be minus 1350 to minus 1150. So about 3300 years ago. That is the estimate of time for Parashara. So it's an internal evidence. You need not have any external evidence. If this is the observation, you can work backward. This works because there is a phenomenon called precession of equinoxes, by which slowly the whole sky picture changes. Okay, so I'll conclude with this. So few more points on necessity of reconstruction despite lack of manuscripts. So very important to tackle questions on foreign influences in our text. So there is always, I wouldn't call it an agenda, but there is some kind of always a drishti on how to point out that Indians borrowed this from Greece or Indians borrowed this from Babylon. Some of them may be true, but then we cannot really accept it without having our own source text, our own analysis from our own drishti. So unless we have a proper kind of at least a database of texts, original texts, or at least in the form of reconstructed texts. Reconstruction doesn't mean you are doing some kind of guesswork. It's with proper analysis and contextual understanding. And to show a continuity. Otherwise, what happens, you know there was a text called Vedanga Jyotisham, which was 3,200 years ago. And then what is the next text you know? You say it is Panchasiddhantika or Aryabhatiyam, which will be 1,500 years ago. What happened in the 2,000 years in between? There is no way we can say anything about this. It seems like a dark age. And so anyone can come back and fill in saying, oh, that is the time Alexander came in. So everything from Greece came in and things like that. So unless we publish texts which are in that space, which belongs to proper Vedangam, one would be Parashara Tantram. The famous text of Lagadha, which is Vedanga Jyotisham itself by name, is available. And one more we are editing at our center, which is Vriddhagargiya Jyotisham. It's a huge text of 5,000 shlokas. These texts need to be available, critically studied, edited, published, and discussed. Then only we can show the continuity, what kind of influence was there. In fact, we suspect that some concepts from here have gone to Babylon. Because, for example, there was a Mercury visibility information. There are 7 numbers involved in Mercury, planet Mercury visibility information. But one of the Babylonian texts states 5 of those numbers. So 7 is the complete data. Why would anyone get 5 and add 2 more? So the other direction may be, the transmission may be in the other direction. And since I was saying in the beginning, Vedanga Jyotisha has been highlighted. It is a calendar text. But then actually our Samhitas, Brahmanam, especially Samhita and Brahmanam of all texts, they have very huge amount of astronomical information. No one has actually explored it in the Adhidaiva sense. That needs to be explored. And the connection from that point till Aryabhata and later people also needs to be explored. For that, we need this. So, anyway, I just wanted to highlight the importance of this text, reconstruction, how manuscriptology helps in reconstruction, how the reconstruction can help in further manuscriptology. In fact, one instance I'll say and then just conclude. There was in this Vriddhagargiya Jyotisham we are working on, the Tithi names, in very old literature, we see that Tithis have special names. Nanda, Bhadra, Jaya, Rikta, Purna, Masa. So the name of the 15 or whatever Tithis go on, they have each special names like Rama, Krishna, like this. So there was a word called Masa, which is 6th Tithi. And it was unclear in all the manuscripts of Vriddhagargiya Jyotisham. But then the original reconstructed Parashara Tantram clearly had Masa in that place. So we could say this is definitely the same name Masa there, most likely. So that is how it helps in further manuscriptology also. Anyway, so I would like to conclude at this point. Thank you for the opportunity. Any questions? Yeah. True. So the current Surya Siddhanta is a very late text. Okay, so the current Surya Siddhanta, according to scholars, is 9th or 10th century. The earlier Surya Siddhanta, which Varahamihira talks about, is earlier. So that is what I mentioned in Pancha Siddhantika. There are other Siddhantas, the 18 Siddhantas, out of which so many have been lost. Surya Siddhanta also is part of the same kind of collective text. So the problem is, people will say things like it's 2 million years old or any such kind of thing. But the reality is that the current text available with us for Surya Siddhanta is a very late text. It has Rashis, which is not there in ancient literature. And so there are many problems which are yet to be settled, including that.
Thank you.
Yeah, we can't accept, right? If they no 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 I let me answer. Okay, no, that is a very detailed topic for Q&A. No, no, no. Let me give you an answer. It is a very detailed question, but let me give you this answer. So texts call themselves to some particular era. That is always there. So the present scholarship, what they do is that with internal evidence of what is stated, both due to linguistics as well as the astronomical information, that is how we date the text. So if that is the criteria taken for Surya Siddhanta, current version of Surya Siddhanta is a late text. That's all I'm saying. Yeah. Okay, can we actually take this offline? Yeah, actually. No, actually, can we take it offline? Time is running out. Okay, yeah, we can discuss. Yeah, of course. Yeah, Kaladasaha Vayam. Dhanyavadaha.
So I am very much thankful to Mr. Anand for a very lively presentation.
Namasabhayai Sabhapatibhyascha. So I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity, especially my guru Mahamahopadhyaya Shri ML Lakshmi Tatachar sir. So mathematics is a subject which is embedded throughout the life. So Vedanga Jyotisha says its importance as yatha shikha mayuranam naganam manayo yatha tadvad vedanga shastranam ganitam murdhani sthitam. As the crest on the head of the peacocks, as the gem on the hood of the serpents, mathematics stands foremost among all the shastras in Vedangas, that is six auxiliaries of Vedas. So I'm fascinated by numbers, counting, without which the mathematics, the study of mathematics or thinking of mathematics would be very difficult. See, in the numbers, many representations from many countries throughout the world, from time immemorial, has been depicting and has been thinking. The thought process is still in progress till this day. But Rig Veda tells a number which is 10 to the power of 12 given by Medhatithi. So Albiruni praises him for this achievement in Albiruni's India. He says Indians ought to be praised for this because they could now count up to 10 to the power of 12, whereas other countries did count up only up to 1,000. So Indians ought to be praised, he says. And then, see, we always go by Westerners' words, no? That is why. And pertaining to this, we have powers of 10 in different texts. So Taittiriya Samhita tells about 100 to 10 to the power of 19, it is called as lokam. Okay. And we can see some series which were found in Vedic texts only, that is from 2 to 20 and 3 to 100. And Atharva Veda contains a series of descending order 99, 88, etc. And then they could know the sum of series also. And Buddhist text by name Lalita Vistara Grantha gives the number, highest number up to 10 to the power of 421 and lowest number as 7 to the power of minus 12. And this our Brahmanandavalli of Taittiriya Upanishad has a sentimental scale of anandas. And then there is another scale of this. This is from Ramayana. So when Ravana asks the number of monkeys in Rama's army, Rakshasa by name Shankha tells us in a scale of 10 to the power of 5. And then the number of monkeys in the army of Rama is the addition of 10 to the power of 10 to 10 to the power of 69. So those many monkeys were there. So my personal view is that this might be some astronomical unit. So this may contain some astronomical aspect in it, which has to be, which is the subject for research. And then we know that Aryabhata has given the correct decimal formula for pi value for pi. And then his another contribution is denoting number through the words. So here are there, he gives ka to ma is 1 to 25, and ya, ra, la, va, he has given some words, and he arranges in vargas and avargas place, and he gives this number for the astronomical units, that is for the revolution of these planets in a Mahayuga. So sun is Q Gru, that is 43,20,000 years in Manusha years, and also the other five planets, this rotations are given there. And then another kind of addition or multiplication is given in the rotation and revolution of these planets in Vedas. See, we have 10 mandalas in Rig Vedas, and then each of them have some suktas. So with respect to Manusha calculations, the addition of two or three mandalas, the number of suktas in two or three mandalas will give us the number of rotations of planets in a Mahayuga. And then with relation to stars, we multiply the number of suktas, and then it gives with stellar calculation, and the calculation is so accurate that it differs only by two or one decimal or 0.1 decimal. So the calculation is so accurate. And I had some other in that PPT. And about this numbers, their origin, it is very fascinating. And even Rigveda contains, in Purusha Sukta contains some numbers, 1, 2, 4, 3 is not there, they say. And then Rudra Prashna contains two series, one odd series from 1 to 33 and another even series from 4 to 48. And Bhaskaracharya the second, using these aspects, using these two series, he has derived the general solution for differential equations. So dy by dx is equal to minus 1 to the power of n, it goes on. Dy by dx to the power of n, like that it goes on. So about the numerals, different kinds of writing were there. We have Brahmi script, we have Kharoshthi script, we have Sharda script, and then sir was telling about Sharda script, that is Bhakshali manuscript is in Sharda script. The importance of Bhakshali manuscript is that it contains some of the mathematical concepts and also some solved problems which are not to be seen in the later texts, Siddhantic texts. And then this Kharoshthi and Brahmi numerals, they are resembled, they are compared with letters. So some of the inscriptions say, the earliest form of numerical in the inscriptions of Ashoka resembles letter Ka, they say. And then Nagari, Nanaghat and Nasik cave forms resemble Ka. In most inscriptions, it resembles the syllable 5, Thru, whilst resembling Ta, Ta, Pu, Bu, Thru, Tra, Na, Bra, Ba are also found. Six, the letter, the number 6, it resembles Prabra, Pha, Pha, Ha, these are all. In most of the inscriptions, they resemble Gra, Gu, the 7, and like it is like Ga. In most cases, 8 resembles Bra. In some inscriptions from this numerical cannot resemble any letter or any syllable. The oldest form of numerals, those in the Nanaghat and Kshatrapa inscriptions cannot be said to resemble any letter or syllable. So thus we have syllables this compared with numbers. And so I conclude with the words of Mahaviracharya, that is Trailokye sacharachare nakinchit vastu tat sarvam ganitena vinanahi. Thank you.
Thank you very much for yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Do you find any instance
in that Rigveda? See, Rigveda place value system is there because to zero is not directly found, okay?
But is there a definition of Shunya?
Definition of Shunya, a direct definition is not there.
Nowhere it's there in Rigveda.
He is asking in Rigveda. Yes.
No, no. No, sir. My point is different. See, the as usual, the Westerners have dated the invention of zero to much later than, just before Bhakshali manuscript and so on. So what I want to know is whether it is much earlier. Was the concept of Shunya known to ancient Indians much earlier? That's the question.
Sir.
How you date the Pingala Sutra? I suggest.
One thing that is mentioned in Veda Rigveda only, to denote 19, we say Ekona Vimshatihi, that is 1 less than 20. Right. So, such numbers are there, but direct mention of 0 is not there in Rigveda.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a very crisp presentation based on the manuscripts available on mathematics.
I'm just the speaker here, but behind this presentation, there is a team working, including my teacher, Dr. Ranjani, and some of my students. And about me, I'm Bama, and I've done my research basically inspired from Imam Sir. If we look at the vision from morning, what we have been seeing is everyone agrees to us. We have a huge amount of knowledge hidden in the manuscripts. And how to use our knowledge? We have come up with four levels. One, preserve the manuscript so that it does not fade away with time. This morning, a few have mentioned. And second step, we just digitize it. Digitization also, a few of them talked about this, the details of this. And the third level, make the digital copy available to the masses. This also we have been trying around. And beyond that, the fourth level is use the knowledge extracted from the third or whatever it is and make it available to the modern day living. Like in the morning, one of the speakers mentioned, can we use the knowledge to cure brain tumor from alchemy? And similarly for other science and technology projects can be used. So these are the four levels with which we can extract knowledge and see how it can be spread to the masses. Now, I want to focus on the talk based on the two things, the last two, three and four. So after digitizing the manuscript, knowledge can be extracted and it can be made available based on the needs of the user as well as based on the technology. And some of the people have mentioned, like Dr. Yoganand and Dr. Sai, as all of them mentioned. I'm also going the same path with crowdsourcing and XML and also Professor Tathacharya's knowledge tree, a similar concept like that. And the second one is the knowledge from manuscript. Can we use it to address the present day science and technology efforts? Because that will attract more people towards this end. So this talk is going to be focused on these two angles. First, it is from the manuscripts. Say, once we have the digitized thing, everything ready, so how are we going to extract it? One, it can be extracted and put it into some kind of a common structure, the standardized structure. It is known as, one thing is commonly available is TEI, Text Encoding Initiative. So given any text, it is an XML format, which I can show you the snapshot on the next slide. We can have all the small snippets as the indexing scheme, and based on the indexing scheme, again, the crowdsourcing mechanism, because without which, in today's world, it is not possible having a humongous text. A crowdsourcing mechanism to capture all the text, the details within the text, and based on this, we can create some mobile applications. So these mobile or web application, we are thinking of as something like a vertical text search engine, which I can show a snapshot of it, a contact extraction application, some kind of visualization application that knowledge tree has been developed, something like what Professor Tathacharya has shown. An e-learning application, a storytelling application for kids, for any user that we can be thinking of. So this is one snapshot. I don't think it is visible, but it is in XML format. What we are doing is we capture the contents, we index those in a scheme which is similar to TEI, and these texts is a very used for a vertical text engine, something we have been working on it towards supporting Jnana Ashwata. Here it is, one example here we have shown us, can we list the animals during the period of Mahabharata? Suppose we give a clause here. So if the search engine has to retrieve based on the indexing scheme and then list it. So this is one strategy with which we are working towards our vision three, the third goal. Another goal that we have been trying hard for past 10, 12 years is, can we see how the knowledge extracted from the source text, can we use it for the present day science and technology? Okay. So one idea was we could use Mimamsa Shastra to interpret, which is used to interpret Vedas. Can we use it for the current computer science generation? Because Mimamsa, without the need of author, it interprets the meaning. So can we have the same concept that can interpret in the computer sense also? This was the idea. And we were successful in developing some of the applications. One was a logical formalism called Mimamsa-inspired representation of actions, which is based only on instructions and actions. The second one was an application for special children, which is based on the Mira action that we developed. Third one is artificial intelligence planning that we compared with the results and we got an interesting one. And fourth one is robotics, and two more applications are in the pipeline. First, I'll just describe a few things from Mimamsa, but I'll not take much time and I'll progress to the application side. In Mimamsa, it says a Vedic topics, it might lead to a conflicting statements at different times. So in order to do that, say Jaimini developed kind of text having 12 chapters and each chapter running into a proper structure. And the details are mentioned here. One is Vishya, Vakya, Samshaya, Purva Paksha, Uttara Paksha and Siddhanta. So the first verse starts with Atato Dharma Jignyasa, therefore an inquiry into the nature of duty. And I'm not going into detail of all that, but after that, the whole lot of the series of the discussion, it concludes saying that duty is desirable at the command of Vedic injunction. So the Vedic injunction is the prime thing to be considered for the duty on which is responsible for dharma. And to undertake any action or to do dharma, the Vedic injunction is necessary, and in order to adopt that, the motivation is very essential. Motivation in the sense, the why the action should be done. That is presented beautifully in Mimamsa. That divides into, I'm not going detail into the interpretation, what is Shavra saying, what is Kumarila Bhatta saying, I'm not going to that. Just taking the concepts, whatever those concepts that we have used for our application, I'm just presenting here. So the two concepts basically was Shabdi Bhavana and Arti Bhavana. Shabdi Bhavana is at the psychological level, which helps to motivate an individual to do an action. So if you see at the first row, everything is specified as Kim Bhavet, Keno Bhavet, and Katam Bhavet. Objective, what is to be done, instrument, how to do it, and auxiliaries, through what means. At the psychological level, if you see, generating Arti Bhavana or to do the initial activity is going to be the objective of the psychological level of Shabdi Bhavana. Then instrument is knowledge of verbal termination, lin in Sanskrit. So whenever they say do this, that is an indication to do an action. And third auxiliary is Arthavada, say eulogy or truism. Why should we do an action? Okay, if I do this action, I will get plenty of appreciation. If I do this action, I will get good result. And so on and so forth. Those will be the kind of eulogy or criticism. And those would enable the psychological level of the motivation of an individual. Second level is the Arti Bhavana, which is the actual activity level. And the objective is going to be the real objective of the sacrifice or the goal of the sacrifice. And the instrument is the actual performance of how they are doing it. And auxiliaries that are mentioned is the instruction interpretation. Given a set of instructions, how can the interpretation be done? Those are the auxiliaries. So we have taken these things into account while we developed our formalism. Yeah. And another important point that Mimamsa was trying to say is separation of Vidhi and Nisheda, which we cannot see in any Western sites so far. And Vidhi is called as positive injunction that we have come up with our own English translation. It cannot be equal. Anyway, it's a positive injunction is say tell the truth or observe nonviolence. It can be positive injunction. And negative injunction is prohibitory statements which says do not take a pen, example. And Mimamsa classifies injunction into several types. A few of these have been mentioned here. Restrictive injunctions are Niyamavidhi. It says, the example we can say, here is pound the corn to remove the husk, Vrighin Avanti. Injunction specifies that corn has to be removed only in that particular manner if there are too many ways. One more example from the present day, I can say is, one may use pen or pencil or tablet to take lecture notes. Use only pen restricts the person to use only pen and not others. But not others is not given here. Use only pen is going to be the restrictive type. Either one is exclusive injunctions or parisankhya vidhi. Exclusion of one form, given all the other forms. Here from Mimamsa, only five animals with five toes may be eaten. That an example straight away from Mimamsa. And when we map it to the real world, assume that one may use pen or pencil, but if we say do not use a tablet, that excludes that from others. And another, this is one of the important classification of vidhi that we have taken into account in our formalism. There is pala vidhi. It says it enjoins the goal, which is from Mimamsa, one who desires heaven should perform fire sacrifice. So perform fire sacrifice is an injunction or instruction, and to reach heaven is the goal. And another one is, how do we connect an instruction with a non-instruction? Say, take for example, if it is raining, take an umbrella. The two parts, the first part, if it is raining, is not an instruction. It is a hetu, it's a reason. And take an umbrella, it is going to be an instruction that giving support to the first part. Then Mimamsa specifies six different criteria for ordering, in the sense that if there are some instruction pieces lying, assume that we have a cooking recipe and all the sequences are jumbled. So it actually specifies how do you sequence into a specific order. And it specifies six different kinds, and out of which for our work we have taken only Shruti Krama, where it is going to be one after the other. The rest also is in progress. And Mimamsa again specifies several interpretation rules which are used for the jurisprudence. But here for our work we have used only two things. One is Vikalpa and another one is Samuchya. One, for Samuchya, it's something like when you have number of instructions put together, ideally we have to do all the instructions. And the optional rule or Vikalpa is, if towards the same goal, if there are two instructions specified, then taking one of the instruction is sufficient. Although it looks very simple for us, from the computational point of view, we have to specify each and everything. So in that sense, if we apply these kind of rules to the machine, the results will be accurate. That's what we have found. So these were some of the concepts that we have taken from Mimamsa directly. It is not any alteration all that, direct borrowing from Mimamsa. So first portion is the action, Mimamsa inspired representation of actions. It is a logical formulation based on the Mimamsa principles. So first, we identified three factors. First one is a motivation, which is got from Shabdi Bhavana and Arti Bhavana. Motivation is intention to achieve the goal is considered to be the prime requirement for performing an action. And the second one is interpretation of instructions. Once we have motivated to perform actions, then we have to interpret whatever the actions is given that are to be correct. So that is interpretation is carried out using the principles or the concepts that we have identified before. And third one is our own idea. It is not borrowed from Mimamsa. In the sense here we are saying, okay, if it is interpreted correctly and if the action is done, the value is yes. Yes stands for satisfaction. And if the action is not done, the value is V, which is for violation. And if there is no intention to reach the goal, then it is N. So we formulated some kind of a truth table kind of thing, but truth table has two values, T and true and false. But for this sense, we have three values, yes, V and N. It stands for satisfaction, violation, and no intention to reach a goal. So for the second point, the instruction interpretation, this is how we are mapping it. For vidhi example, I've just taken as return the paper, nishedha, do not take the pen, pala vidhi, if you want to write, that to write is the intention. Take the pen, ketu ketu madbhava, if there is a pencil, take it. Shruti krama, write on paper, then fold it. Samuchya, take a pen and take the paper. You could see the difference between Shruti krama and Samuchya. Shruti krama is take, do one after the other, but both are and. Both will be, say in English, if you take the logicians, if you take the proposition logic, both are and. There is no difference between one after the other, except in propositional dynamic logic. here we can clearly see a difference if we bring in the sequential part. Then vikalpa, it is going to be exclusive or kind. To reach the same goal, either do this or do that. And one more example is the Vinayoga Vidhi, which is with auxiliary. Say, write the assignment with pen. That pen is going to act as an auxiliary for writing. So this is the two table kind of thing that we have formulated. I'm not giving the entire two table. We can look at the resource, which I can give you at the last. This is the relation between Vidhi and Nisheda. Again, Mimamsa specifies Vidhi separately and Nisheda separately. It is not a negation of other. Negation of Vidhi is not Nisheda, and negation of Nisheda is not Vidhi. Both are separate. And this is Palavidhi, which is conditional imperative enjoining the goal. Suppose phi, I take walk every day for 45 minutes, and theta is going to be the goal, to stay healthy. We can have the formulation that if it is yes, yes is satisfied. If a person satisfies the rule, and if theta, if there is an intention to reach the goal, then the value is yes. Then, or if yes, and if it is false, then it is n. There is no intention to reach the goal. And if the intention to reach the goal is true, in the sense to stay healthy is true, and if phi is violated, if not, then the whole thing goes as B. So this is how we formulated the rules. And this is for Shruti Krama. After one step, after doing one action, if you do the other action, then it is satisfied, else it is not satisfied. So these formalism, we tried to look at these formalism and we thought where to apply, and we identified three areas. The first area was artificial intelligence planning. Second one was identifying the application for the task analysis for special children. It's built on the similar principle. And third one is robotics. The first one is artificial intelligence planning, where a robot is given a task. Again, this is a toy example or a benchmarking example in computer science to see how the optimal plan does. And in computer science, ultimately we measure everything in terms of space and time. Space in the sense how much memory is it occupied, and time, how fast the process runs. Okay. So when we take the time, if you see the blocks, the idea is simple. If you see the blocks A, B, C, D up to F down, the robot has to take the block A and put it on top of the other. The left side is going to be the left portion of it is the initial state or the starting stage for the robot, and the right hand side of it is going to be the final stage or the goal. So the robot has to pick one by one and put it on top of the other. Okay? So this is a very simple example, but it will demonstrate how our formalism based on Mira works. So if you look at the comparison side, the optimal plan which is given in the literature was 19, whereas with ours, the representation, it is 10. So you can look at until 40, we have done that, but we can extend up to 1 million. Okay? So you can see that the length is considerably reduced, in the sense the time is considerably reduced when we bring in this kind of formalism. The second application is robotics. Again, here I have given one example. Here we have compared with respect to the temporal logic robot. So assume that a robot moves from location hall to porch, and hall and porch are adjacent to each other. So if the robot sees a person, he has to switch on the camera. And the So assume that robot starts in hall and camera in off position. This is the simple task of that is given. Okay. The table that is given is with respect to the linear temporal logic part. Okay. So the first thing reads as the person is not there. The second person, there is no camera available. The third line says that according to the temporal logic, if the robot sees a person, it has to switch on the camera. And the fourth, the robot has to go to porch often, infinitely often. Those are terminologies with respect to temporal logic. But when we have the same kind of formulation with respect to Mira, it goes quite simple because it is based on instructions, whereas the temporal logic is based on the states. For the same example, this is what is happening. Again, I said everything is measured in terms of space, how much space our memory is occupied. So when we go into the LTL, the linear temporal logic part, you can see one circle. Each circle represents the states. State is going to be some kind of memory element. So if the number of states are exploding, that is bad. Then, when we have a temporal logic kind of thing coming into the picture, the state space is going to be huge. Here, if you see P2 hall with no camera, this cross represents no camera, and there are two states coming up, P1 porch and P1 camera, and that arrow indicates if the robot sees a person, then it has to switch on. So this graph, this state diagram represents the number of states that needs to be inside the machine. But when we have the logical formalism based on Mira, this state space is not needed. That is our idea. And instead, since it works only based on the instruction, it is straightforward. The third difference, there are actually 7 or 8 differences which we have listed in our publication, but this is going to be one of the important difference. What happens is in the temporal logic or other logic parts, everything, the action, what they are doing is represented in by means of states. In the sense, if I have this element right here, then it is, and if I move it to this, it will take a snapshot of, say the robot will take a snapshot of whatever it is right here, then it will take a snapshot of, say the device in this hand, and it will catch hold of that snapshot and say that an action is done. Although there is no transition of the object being moving from one part to the other. So that's what is in the table mentioned above. There, at that time, the camera is false, and at the 1049 camera is true, which sends that the action is being done. So, the difficulty with these values is, suppose if the robot is broken and someone manually keeps the robot from one point to the other, still the linear temporal logic part will say that yes, the action is being done, but actually it is not. Whereas using the MIMASA-based representation, we can clearly say whether robot actually moved or not. So in that sense, our representation was fairly accurate. So this is a third application, and the fourth application is, what we are trying to do is have a set of instructions. Any instruction in the world, can we categorize it based on the classification from MIMASA? And this we compared with Zhang publication, and we saw that we could have more number of classification which is resulted from MIMASA. One is Nisheda, second one is Samuchya, third one is Vikalpa, and fourth, Palavidi Hetu Hetu Madbhava. In the English translation, it is all available in Zhang's, but the other part, it is not available, though it is only a partial list. Now we are working on a few more interpretation rules and few more classification. That what we are trying to do is, given any instruction in the world, can we classify it according to the MIMASA side? Then the last application I will be talking with respect to this topic is deontic logic. This actually we are in contact with an Austrian group who is working on a similar idea. The deontic logic deals with obligation, permission, and prohibition. It deals with majorly two types. One is ought to do and ought to be. Ought to do is going to be contrary to duty example per se. Say, suppose you take an example, you ought not to go on a slippery path, and another rule says if you go, go slowly. The third rule say you go. There is a contradiction between that, and if you feed into the machine, it will say yes, there is a contradiction. And these are inconsistent according to standard deontic logic, STL. But when we talk about MIMASA, it separates Vidhi and Nisheda into two parts. Imagine we have two baskets. One basket has only Vidhi and one basket again Nisheda. There is no negation between the two. So if we are going to adopt those concepts, definitely we can solve this inconsistency. So where again these can be used, we can use it in fault tolerant networks. So concluding, our knowledge from manuscripts, it can be captured, I have put easily, but with some kind of effort, watching the talks from morning, yes, we need a little bit of effort. We can capture those in digital age. And one thing is we can spread the knowledge by creating mobile and apps. And to do that, yes, we need some effort. And third one is use those knowledge again for the technology. It's kind of a reverse way what Dr. Sai said. Now, channelize that towards the Indic technology. What I'm trying to say is the reverse way. Use the Indic technology to address the science and technology so that people turn towards our side. And possible challenges that we face in the last few years where people, of course, we are not getting much people. More students come to me for AI projects, robotic projects, but when I say it is Mimamsa based, people run away. We have to catch hold of them. We need some way to attract them. And one method I thought is, yes, we can channelize something like, can we apply those concepts to address these needs? And the second time is the time. Of course, we are all working with them, but still that can be captured. And third challenge that we faced was the finance. These were some of the references used, and whatever I talked in this application, it is available as publication and available in my, this is my email ID. The second link is where all my publications are, and third link is where all the programming codes are. Thank you very much, and if you have questions, I'll be happy to answer.
I don't want to test your patience. I'll close within 5 minutes. So the first paper was on recreating the text of Parashara Tantram. Of course, recreation of such text is very much necessary, and particularly one S.S. Raghavachar has created the Upanishad Bhashya based on Ramanuja's interpretations in Sri Bhashya. It is Ramanuja's views on Upanishads. So he has recreated the text. And probably in Shivashim also you come across so much of information about that. Some previous Acharya said like this, another Acharya said like this, etc. Even in Vyakarana you come across. Audulomihi, Apishalihi, Ityadi. In Vyakarana also you come across that. But one particular caution should be there. That is, many a times we take it for granted, all these are the original texts created by those people. Tadaha Parashara, if it is stated like that, it may be the view of Parashara stated by the author himself in his own words, or it may be the original words of Parashara only. That has to be very seriously tested, and after examining these things properly, then you have to recreate the text. This is my observation with regard to the first paper. Second paper was presented by Gayatri, and she beautifully highlighted the importance of Vedas and other Shastras, which have contributed so much to the mathematical literature, and particularly the Indian contribution to mathematics. I congratulate her for that, and I also congratulate Mr. Anandan for presenting such a wonderful paper. The third paper was, to some extent, I am also responsible for that. When Dr. Ranjini Gayatri and Bama had come to Melkota, I had told several times, you should re-examine the rules of interpretation according to Mimamsa. It may be according to Upakrama, Upasamhara, Abhyasa, Apurvata, Phalam, Arthavada, Upapatti, Chalingam, Tatpariyanirne. How to decide about the purport of the whole text, which may run into 500 pages, 1000 pages, etc. They have given certain rules and regulations. And they have done extensive work on different types of bhavanas, vidhi, nishedha, etc. Vidhi, and in Mimamsa Shastra, the total Mimamsa Shastra deals with vidhi and nishedha only. And vidhi nishedha has been beautifully mentioned in Jaimini's first sutra, Chodana Lakshanortho Dharma. Dharma is nothing but some sort of enjoyment. Either you do this or not do that. So it is vidhi, nishedha, etc. How to convert this into an information and feed it to the robots so that they can also do this work. That particular idea was very beautifully mentioned by Bhama, and I think they have to carry forward this particular research work, which will be most useful after Dr. Sai Sisarla builds up all the instruments to get the text exactly. as it is presented in the original manuscript. So all these papers are very much useful, and I hope that we will be progressing in manuscriptology if we adopt many of the ideas given by these people. Thank you very much.